Okay, so in this video, we're just going to be looking at the review guide, and I'll go through the entire review guide and just kind of talk about each problem and how I think about it. All right, so if we're looking here at number one, we're talking about angle DBE. Well, angle DBE is right here. That has a vertex on this circle. So an angle that has a vertex on the circle is called inscribed angle, which is K. There's only two angles here, a central angle and an inscribed angle. So really, process of elimination, it's not a central angle, it's just an inscribed angle. So if I look down here, I see, oh, DOE is my only other angle. And DOE is here, and that vertex is right there in the center. So when the vertex is in the center, it's a central angle. So DOE must be J. So those are done. Now, if I'm looking at DB, DB goes from one edge to the other through the center. So that's a diameter. AB, see, this is segment AB, this is line AB. So AB, that's a segment, is a chord. But line AB, where it continues, that's a secant. So we just use those two and diameter. Okay, so what am I left with? DA, if I'm looking at DA, that's an arc, right? You see the arc right there. So arc DA, well, that's only two letters. So the only arcs I have here are major arcs, minor arcs, and a semicircle, which is actually an arc that's half of a circle. So DA is small, so it's a minor arc, right? Where are my other arcs? I have DEA and DAB. So DA, if I go the long way around DA, so DEA, well, that's a major arc, so this one must be H. That only leaves my other DAB as a semicircle A, which makes sense because DB is the diameter, and this has a starting point at D and an ending point at B, so that must be and connect the diameter in an arc, which makes a semicircle. Okay, so what am I left with here? Semicircle's gone, diameter's gone, chord's gone, secant's gone. Major arcs, minor arcs, central angles, inscribed angles, they're all gone. So I have a radius, a tangent, a center, and a point of tangency. So OE, let's get rid of some of this. OE goes from the center to the edge, that's a radius. P, that's a point in the center, so that's G. Radius is gone, center's gone. Now I'm left with a tangent and a point of tangency. Well, point must be E. If E is a point of tangency, well then this, well, HG touches G in a point of tangency. So if E is a point of tangency, G is a point of tangency. So HJ must be a tangent. Okay, so that's the vocabulary. And I think you can kind of think your way through it by breaking it down into the angles, breaking it down into the types of segments and lines, breaking it down into the types of arcs. Then you have some points here that you can think about and use process of elimination. Now these problems, we're thinking about angles. And it's all about where your vertex is, right? If the vertex is on the outside, that I'm going to be subtracting. 110 minus 70 divided by 2 equals x. So 40 divided by 2 equals x. So x equals 20. Here, my vertex is on the circle. So that means it's just going to be half of this arc, because there's nothing to add or subtract. And this 85 is a central angle. Central angles and arcs are the same. So x is just equal to 85 divided by 2. And you don't have to turn that into a decimal. You can just leave it as a fraction. That's OK. All right. Number 15 is very similar to number 13, except I don't have this arc to subtract yet. But what I do have is this arc here, which is 70. And the relationship between the red and the blue is that 70 plus x, well, not x, we'll call it y, so we don't confuse ourselves. 70 plus y equals 360. And there's our y right there. So that means that y has to be 290. Okay? Since I know that this is 290, now I can set up the problem like I did in number 13. 290 minus 70 divided by 2 equals x. So that gives me 220 divided by 2 equals x, which equals 110. Okay? So again, anytime the vertex is on the outside, you're going to end up setting up a problem where you're subtracting and dividing by 2. Here your vertex is on the circle, so you just divide it by 2. Here your vertex is on the circle, so you're going to do the same thing. You're just going to divide by 2. The question is, how big is this arc? And there's no numbers to help you this time like we had here in number 15. But this is the diameter, so this is 180. So that means that x equals 180 divided by 2. And that reduces to 90 degrees. Okay? So again, outside the circle, you subtract, divide by 2. Sometimes you have to find the missing piece by subtracting from 360, as we did here. When the vertex is on the circle, like in 14 and 16, you divide the arc by 2. Sometimes you got to find the arc with the missing pieces. So the only way we make this more complicated is by making you find the arc first, before you divide. The next page here, we have some more angle problems. Again, the vertex is on the outside. So I need to subtract this arc from this arc, because those are the ones inside the circle, or inside of the angle. But I don't know this. So how do I find it? Well, I do 360 minus 120 minus 170, and I end up with 70 degrees. So this is 70. Because these three pieces here, 1, 2, 3, add up to 360. Outside the circle means subtraction and then division. 170 minus 70 is 100 divided by 2. So x equals 50. Okay, 18 and 19 are new to what we have seen, and that's because the vertex this time is in the middle somewhere. It's not exactly the middle. I know that's not the middle because these numbers are different from each other, so it can't be the center. If it was the center, they would be equal to each other. But if it's on the outside, I subtract. If it's on the inside, I add and divide by 2. So x equals 110 over 2. So x equals 55 degrees. here we have the same problem, except that when I do it, I get that angle. 70 plus 30 divided by 2 equals y. That's the angle in between the two arcs. So that's 100 divided by 2, so y equals 50. I'll write that a little nicer. That means this angle is 50, but I want x. What's the relationship between x and 50? Well, x plus 50 equals 180, because they're a linear pair. So x has to equal 130. Okay? So now we've seen all three of our possible positions for the vertex. If it's outside, you subtract. If it's inside, you add. If it's on the edge, you just divide by 2. Now we can see if some, these are kind of similar problems with some special relationships. All right? Number 20 has a quadrilateral inside of a circle. And what that happens is x covers this amount and 65 covers this amount. So altogether, x and y, or x and 65 together, will equal 360. They're inscribed, so I need to divide that by 2. So what do I get? I get x plus 65 equals 180. So x equals 115. It's the same idea. Inscribed angles divide by 2. When I add these two together, I get the whole circle. It doesn't matter what the little pieces are. It only matters what the pieces are together, which is 360 divided by 2, 180. All right? Again, this is the same problem. I have a vertex on the circle. What do? I divide the arc by 2 to equal the angle. That's an algebra problem. Multiply both sides by 2, and you get x equals 240 degrees. Okay. So hopefully you're following along and seeing that we're really just working on the same types of things. Where is the vertex? Is it inside? Is it outside? Is it in the middle? Here, my vertex is in the middle, so I need to know this arc right here. Sorry, the vertex is on the edge of the circle, so I need to know this arc. I don't know it. So I have to do a little bit of work to analyze the picture and figure out what I know. Well, this 130 takes care of that. Since it's in the center, they're the same. Since this is a diameter, these two have to add up to 180. That means 50 divided by 2 equals x. So x has to be 25. It's the same idea as what we did before. The only difference is you have to work to get the information that you need. All right, so let's take a look at the next one. This 40 tells me this, right? So it's the same problem, just working the opposite way. If this is 40, y divided by 2 equals 40, so y equals 80. Okay, if this is 80, then this has to be 100, so that I get 180. If this is 100, then x equals 100. All right? Same idea, just shown to you in a slightly different way. Here's my vertex. It's on the circle, so I need to divide this arc by 2. But it didn't tell me what it was. So what do? 360 minus 100 minus 60 gives me 200. 200 divided by 2 equals 3x plus 19. So 100 equals 3x plus 19. Minus 19. 81 equals 3x. X equals 27. It's just algebra from there. Once you understand these principles, you just have to be able to set up the equation from the principle, from the theorem, and then solve the equation properly. All right. This angle covers this arc. This angle covers this arc. But we're talking about the same arc. We don't know what it is, but if I divide it by 2, it equals 3x plus 17. So 3x plus 17 equals, we'll call it y. Y divided by 2. But that equals 5x minus 3 as well. So that means 3x plus 17 has to equal 5x minus 3. Just set them up equal to each other. You don't need the y over 2. It doesn't matter what it is. They're both going to equal it. So minus 3x minus 3x plus 3 plus 3, 20 equals 2x, so x equals 10. The same idea as what we've been doing. There's nothing different. You just have to figure out where the vertex is. Is it inside the circle, outside the circle, or is it on the circle, on the edge? Okay. So, the next section is talking about segments. There's only two things to know about segments. If they're chords, if they're both on the inside, that point of intersection is happening inside the circle. It's just the inside times the inside, 4 times 7, because that makes a line, and equals 14 times x, because that makes a line. So 28 equals 14x, x equals 2. When it happens outside of the circle, we need to add these together. And then we'll multiply the outside times the whole. 8 times x plus 8 equals 12 times 22. Distribute. I believe that's 264. So 8x equals 200. X equals 25. This is the same idea. The interaction is happening outside. So add these together. Now, the 6 doesn't have anything to add to, so it's just 6. But it's the same idea. Outside times the whole thing. So 4 times x plus 4 equals 6 times 6. So 4x plus 16 equals 36. 4x equals 20. X equals 5. Now I didn't show every algebraic step there, but hopefully if you get to this setup, you can do it algebraically and get to 5. Okay? So that's the main thing you're doing here. Nothing too tricky here. We're not trying to make any big surprises. It's outside, x plus 2, and that one's 8. 2 times x plus 2 equals 3 times 8. 2x plus 4 equals 24. 2x equals 20. X equals 10. Now 30 and 31 are a little different, because they're both tangents. Neither one of them has anything on the inside. So tangents, when they're both tangent, they have to be equal. X squared plus 34 equals 50. So x squared equals 16. And here's where you have to be careful. Take the square root of both sides, and you get x equals plus 4 or negative 4. It will give you either one of those. If I square 4, I get 16. If I square negative 4, I get 16. So I get two possible answers. If I put them in here, I still get a positive answer, so I have to keep both of them, because both of them will work in the problem. 7x minus 14 equals 3x minus 2 plus 14. 4x equals 12, x equals 3. And that's segments, right? There's only two possible things you can do. You either add up, when it's on the outside, you add up the outside and the inside, you get the total. Multiply outside times the total and set it equal to the outside times the total. Or when it's on the inside like this, part times part equals part times part. Okay. Anytime you see something coming from the center of a circle, it will cut it in half. So the whole thing is equal to two of the small pieces. That's true. CE is a diameter, PB is a radius. It doesn't matter, not part of each other. A radius, right, this is diameter equals 2 times the radius. That's true. That's also true for the arcs. If the chords are congruent, then the arcs are congruent. And if the chord is cut in half, then the arc is cut in half. Right? And that's true for this larger part as well. So, if this is 270, then this has to be 90. And they just want this little piece, so that's 45 degrees. If this whole thing is 16, then that makes both of them 8. Now, gives me a different set of numbers here. It says that this arc is 68, well then this angle is 68. Okay. Halfway done. So when we're looking here, right, it tells me this is 2 and this is 5. So my radius is 7. AP is a radius, so it has to also be 7. Right triangle. So what's that? X squared plus 5 squared equals 7 squared. So x squared plus 25 equals 49. X squared equals 24. So x equals 2 root 6. If you can't get to 2 root 6, at least tell me square root 24. If this is 2 root 6, and this is 2 root 6, so AB is 4 root 6. All right. CD is 16, so both of these are 8. PA is 6. Well, there's again, there's another right triangle right there. 6 squared plus 8 squared equals x squared. 36 plus 64 equals x squared. 100 equals x squared. X equals 10. AC is 8. PC is 10. All right. Again, I go through this quickly, so try not to make the videos too long. If you need, watch it again. Slow it down. Pause it. Go back over the small parts that you need repetition on. Okay. When I see this, I see an isosceles triangle. If this is 40, this is 80. If this is 40, then this has to be the same. So 2x plus 40 equals 180. So 2x equals 140. So x equals 70. So both of these are 70 degrees, which means this is 140 and this is 140. Well, 140 plus 140 plus 80 is 360, because that covers the entire circle. ABC is 70 degrees, AC is 140 degrees, and you see how that all fits together. Okay, so when I'm looking here at WZ and PW, I'm assuming that this is tangent. In order for this to work, I have to know that that's a tangent line, which creates a right triangle. WZ is 15, PW is 8, PZ, what's that whole thing? That's 8 squared plus 15 squared equals y squared. That's 17. So if this is 17 and this is 8 because it's a radius, that has to be 9. Because 8 and 19 have to add up to be 17. They're both radiuses, so they both have to be 8. Here we see a different type of tangent problem. They're tangent, so they're congruent. 4 and 4. Tangent, so congruent. Tangent, so congruent. AP is 3. BC is 11. I could find the perimeter. That's 7. That's 11. That's 10. So the perimeter, if we were to ask you something like that, would be 28. Okay. So this is a very similar problem to what we saw in number 41. But we're looking here at what covers angle 1, angle 2 covers that much, and angle 3 covers that much. So that means that 1 plus 2 plus 3 has to equal 360 divided by 2. Well, 4 covers this much, 5 covers this much, and 6 covers that much. So 4 plus 5 plus 6 equals 360 divided by 2. So that is 180, and this is 180. When I add them together, I get 360. So if I add up all the angles, I end up with 360 degrees. All right. So we're looking at the last, well, there's two more sections left. One is on equations of a circle, and the last section that we'll talk about is, we'll cover arc length and area of sectors. So we're almost there. If I look at this picture, I have a center here, so that is the point 2, negative 3. If I count over, the radius is 2, which means that my diameter would be 4, 2 times 2. Right? Radius, diameter equals 2r. The equation, right, is x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared. And remember, the center is hk. So my equation, x minus 2 squared plus y, and if it's minus negative 3, it becomes plus 3 squared. My radius was 2. If I square that, I get 4. That's what I want to see. All right. Now I give you the equation, and I want you to tell me all the pieces. This was the graph. You tell me the equation. Here's the equation. Tell me the center. Negative 1, 2. because it's the opposite. R squared equals 16, R equals 4. Diameter is 8. So negative 1, 2. Now I'll count up 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then I'll just draw a rough circle in there. And there's your graph. Okay, so again, this emphasizes the main things you need are the center and the radius. So I didn't give you a graph. I just give you the center and the radius. X minus negative 3 becomes x plus 3. Y minus 5 squared equals square root of 6 squared. Well, that's just x plus 3 squared plus y minus 5 squared equals 6. Simplify that if you can. Diameter is 10, so my radius is 5. X minus 2 squared plus y plus 4 squared equals 25, because you have to square the radius. Now it gets a little trickier. They gave me h and k, and they gave me x, y. They did not give me a r. So I do 1 minus 7 squared plus negative 6 plus 2 squared equals r squared. And I need to be able to calculate that. So that's 36 plus 16 equals 52. So now that I have my r squared, I'm going to rewrite the equation with the center and my x and y's and my r squared. There's no reason to take the square root of 52 or reduce that radical, because what I really want is r squared anyway. So that's that. And 50 is like the hardest type of question that you'd see with one of these, because they don't give you the center and they don't give you the radius. So you have to find them both. Well, the center of a diameter is going to be located at the midpoint, right? So the midpoint is negative 5 plus 1 over 2, 5 plus negative 3 over 2, which means it is negative 2, 1. There's my center. So now I do like I did before. You can pick either one of these you want. I'll pick this one. This is my HK. I'll pick that as my XY. So negative 5 plus 2 squared plus 5 minus 1 squared equals r squared. So that's 9 plus 16, so that's 25. So then I go back and rewrite it. X plus 2 squared plus y minus 1 squared equals 25. And that's how you would solve when they don't give you the radius and they don't give you the center. Find the center with the midpoint formula, find the radius squared with the equation of a circle. Okay. Now, if you want to figure out if a point lies on the circle, you need the equation. This equation, given this center and this radius, let me just get myself a little bit of room here. That equation is going to be x plus 1 squared plus y minus 2 squared equals 13, because that's the square root of 13 squared. So these become x and y's. So I would do 2 plus 1 squared plus 3 minus 2 squared equals 13. Well, let's see, that gives me 9 plus 1. That's not going to work. Then I'll try it again with the next one. This gives me 2 plus 1 squared plus 4 minus 2 squared equals 13. So that's 3 plus, sorry, that's 9, because 3 squared is 9. 4 minus 2 is 2 squared, it's 4. 9 plus 4 does equal 13, so there's one of my answers. And you just keep doing that with each of these points. So, plus 1 squared plus 0 minus 2 squared equals 13. Negative 3 squared is 9, negative 2 squared is 4. That one works as well. So, negative 1 plus 1 squared plus 2 minus 2 squared equals 13. No, 0 plus 0 does not work. So we have two answers that work. All right? And that's because they made the equation true. So that's what you're looking for. Which points make the equation true? Just make sure that you write the equation correctly. Otherwise, your answers will be wrong. Okay. Last section here looks back at arc length and area of a sector. This is important that you understand that the arc length and the area of a sector are just fractions of the total circumference and a fraction of the total area. If this is 80, this is 80. So in terms of pi, this would be 80 out of 360. Circumference equals 2 pi r, area equals pi r squared. So this would be 80 times 2 times 10 times pi. Now, if I was to calculate that, I end up with 40 pi over 9 centimeters. That's in terms of pi. In terms of pi means you don't multiply by pi. If I do multiply by pi and actually divide by 9, I end up with 13.96 centimeters. Around that, I get 14.0 centimeters. So if I wanted you to round it to the nearest tenth, that's what I would want to see. All right? If I'm talking about area of a shaded sector, it's the same thing, 80 over 360, but this time I'm going to be multiplying by the area formula, which would be 10 squared pi. And if I calculate that, that gives me 200 pi over 9 centimeters squared, whereas a decimal, 69.8. centimeters squared. Alright? Over here, you're doing the same thing. It's just our fraction would be different because our angle is different. Sometimes they're not going to give you the angle and you have to do some work to get to it. But it's that same idea that a whole circle adds up to 360, half a circle is 180. Kind of do a little bit of math to figure out what you need. This one's 120 over 360. Times 2 pi times 6, which ends up reducing to 4 pi inches. Whereas a decimal, 12.6 inches. 120 over 360 multiplied by the area, which is 36 pi, 6 squared, which gives me 12 pi inches squared, or 37.7 inches squared. And that's really all there is to these, just making sure that you can get the formulas right, get your fraction right. Okay, So we're looking at a problem like this. You have to understand what, you can't calculate the area of a ring. All you can calculate is the area of a circle. So understand that there is a large circle here that's shaded, a medium circle that's not shaded, and a small inner circle that is shaded. So once you understand that, you can find, that means that all three of those are three. The area of the large circle would be 9 squared pi. The area of the middle circle would be 6 squared pi, and the area of the small circle would be 3 squared pi. So if I have 81 pi, I take out 36 pi, because that's the blank, the empty, the white, the clear circle. I'm taking the whole thing out, but then I put some of it back in. So once you do all that, you end up with a total area of 54 pi centimeters squared. And the last thing here, they tell me that this whole thing is 9. I don't know this part, so I'll call that x, and this part is 6. Well, those are segments, so that's just the outside 6 times the outside 6 equals x times 9. Because 9 represents the whole thing already, there's nothing to add. So 36 equals 9x, so x equals 4. So this piece is 4 now. It's not what it asked for. It asked for the diameter. So if the whole thing is 9 and this part is 4, this has to be 5. So RC has to equal 5. Okay, so I hope this video helps you understand all the concepts that are in this review guide, and hopefully you'll be able to do very well in the test. Go back through it, watch the parts that you need, try some practice problems, go back to the classworks that you have. If there's anything you haven't answered already, try them again. Now that you kind of have a better understanding of what you're doing, go back to some of the problems, try them again, retry them, and study, and then I'll see you in class to take the test.